Okay, we're going to go over a high-profile case today. The journalist that was convicted of, you know, brandishing, waving a gun at a rally protest. And I want to bring back an older case that I talked about back in the day when I had to do 15-minute increments. Yeah, I know that part one, but yeah. And I want to compare and contrast, okay? 2010, summer. I was taking a summer class on Wednesday nights at the university. And a friend of mine who was 5 years younger than me, we went to the same high school, but she was 5 years younger than me, we didn't know each other. We had worked together at the supermarket a couple years earlier, and now we're going to the same university. And we passed it in the hall on our night class, summer 2010, Wednesday night. And it was a simple pass from the hall, mwah. And that's it. Nothing else. No talking, no class together, none of that bullshit. A couple months go by, I'm in Florida. And I'm hearing that some guys that I knew had a friend 3 years younger than me that was stabbed in Manhattan at a fight. Nothing else. Then, a week later, I'm on Facebook, and my friend from the university, she's posting justice was done today. And then right below that was someone else saying, I'm disgusted.
Huh?
They were the same person. My friend who I worked with, okay, and at the university, her boyfriend was the so-called killer. Her and her boyfriend were at a party in Manhattan. We live in Yonkers. And you know how you go to a party or a wedding and you got people that you don't know, they're the friend of the friend of the friend, okay. They're at a party in Manhattan. And there's a group of guys also from Yonkers that didn't know them. And I've heard a million different stories. I've heard they had the shipping at him. I heard there was a shoving match. I even heard there was a bottle thrown at him that ended up not being true or some shit. But there was a problem. Rather than call NYPD, security just threw him out of the building. Get the fuck out. The party still continued, but these people involved in this particular incident were thrown out of the party. I heard there was a video camera on a surveillance camera somewhere, and if that's true, the surveillance camera overrides everybody. But there were two different stories. One story is that he came out, he was a skinny kid, a computer geek, okay, and they say he took a pocket knife that he used for work out of his pocket, and the pocket knife was so harmless, so to speak, that it was even New York City legal. And he was waiting for them to come out, yelling, I have a knife, and these six or seven big guys came out, and he ran up and stabbed one in the chest and ran away. And the girlfriend was coming out, and they ran away. They ran to the hospital, and when he found out that the guy had died, he surrendered to the police. Now, the other side of the story, and I don't know what the camera saw, but the other side of the story was he was thrown out. He was waiting on the corner for the girlfriend to come out of the building. He was punched in the face by these men who approached him, thrown on the ground and beaten. And in the scuffle, he picked up the knife and stabbed the guy in the chest. He ran away and then went to the hospital and then found the guy was dead and then surrendered. Now, him losing his shirt and his shoes in the scuffle goes a long way to backing up his theory that he was attacked, okay? And the fact that he went to the hospital for medical treatment, you know, and then found out the guy had died and surrendered to the police, that goes a long way into backing up the theory that he, in his own mind, thought he was committing self-defense. Because if you commit a cold-blooded fucking murder, you're not going to go to the hospital in that town and then go to the police right after that. You're going to get the fuck out of town. You're going to get out of the country. Now, he was sent to city jail, Rikers Island, for a week. And a grand jury was convened. Now, a grand jury where we are is 23 people. Grand jury in Ferguson, Missouri is 12 people. Some grand juries are 18. It all depends. And the grand jury is asked by the prosecutor, this is what happened, and these are the charges that I might consider. Which of these charges should I make? If the grand jury cannot make up their mind, you're free by default. If the grand jury makes up their mind that you should be charged, you go free. The grand jury has to make up their mind, depending on how many jurors, what state you're in, what the law says, X amount of jurors have to vote to indict. So X amount of jurors tell the prosecutor to indict. Then new jury entirely, courtroom, judge, prosecutor, defense attorney, witnesses, evidence, trial, okay? This is a Manhattan City, this is a New York City court, which means only people from New York City can be called in for the jury. You can't call guys in New Jersey or Westchester or fucking, you know, Rochester for the jury. It's only a New York City jury. And the New York City jury, okay, the same New York City that votes 80% to 20% liberal Democrat, decided that this guy acted in self-defense and he was free. I haven't spoken to the girlfriend in a while. I assume she's doing okay. But, you know, her identity was kept out of the public eye. Ironically, the next semester in school, I did my term paper for law, and I did my term paper on self-defense law, and guess what? This is one of the cases I referred to in the term paper, but I didn't tell anybody that the girl went to the school, nor did I tell anybody that I knew the girl personally. Okay? Now, that's an example. In this particular case, we had a journalist who is at a rally. He's a journalist at the rally, which means he's not participating for or against, he's just videotaping it and reporting it in compliance with the First Amendment. And at least 10 or 12 guys start accosting him. And they're all Black Lives Matter people, and Black Lives Matter is a terrorist group that wants cops dead, that wants white people dead, okay? They're a terrorist group, no question there. They're the new Black Panthers. And he's being threatened, he's being yelled at, and he starts to back away. He's backing away. I'm running out of room here, but he's backing away. And he says, leave me alone, get away, get away, get away. And after a while, he's pushed, and then he pulls out his gun from concealment. He's backing away, leave me alone. He backs away. His own crew members are following him. He's backing away. He's not going forward, he's going backward. And the crew members are trying to get him out of the area, calm him down, tell him to get away, tell him to retreat. The other guys are walking around like the other side of the aisle. Like, oh my God, look at that guy pull a gun on us. The police didn't do anything, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to put the link below to the video so you can see yourself. And long story short, when the investigation comes down, he's convicted of 37 charges. Brandishing, whatever. There's about 37 charges between felony and misdemeanor he's convicted of. And from what I gather watching this video, you're going to see it in the link below. I watched it, and I thought that he was okay. But the jury found he went before a jury. Now, most guys don't go to the jury. 93% of guys plead guilty. Another couple of guys, the charges dropped. Another couple of guys go for a bench trial where the judge tries you. Only 1 out of 100 guys gets a jury. Okay? Okay, it's very, very rare that you would actually get a jury sitting. There are guys called to jury duty so they can be on call God after the trial comes up. But juries don't happen that often. Jury trials are 1 in 100. And he's convicted. And now he was doing everything that I tell you to do. Don't turn your back on the suspect because they might run after you and get from behind. He was backing away while keeping his eyes on the people. Okay? He did pull out his gun when he felt threatened and pointed it. But as he's backing away. Now, if you're backing away, I always say, God forbid you have to shoot. The fact that you're backing away is going to go a long way into backing up your theory that you didn't want to shoot, that it was a last resort, that you were provoked beyond, you know, beyond measure. I didn't want to shoot, but I had to. I felt my life was in imminent danger and I had no choice. Okay? Backing away sometimes resolves the problem. In this case, there was no problem. Physically on the scene. But if he did not back away, they could have attacked him. Okay? So he backed away, he pulled the gun, and as he's backing away, he's telling him, get away from me, leave me alone, I don't want to do this. He had, later on, they said he had 120 rounds of ammunition on him. And some guys thought it was excessive. Some guys might have thought, the jury thought that was a cause for prosecution or a cause for conviction. Because, wait a minute, if you got that much fucking ammo on you, you must be looking for trouble. Well, I mean, I don't know. I mean, there's no real law. Is there a law that says you have to have X amount of magazines and you can't have X amount of magazines? I mean, I don't know. I mean, even if you have a 10-round mag ban, okay, you got 12 10-round mags in you. First of all, 99% of the time, when the first shot is fired, that's it. If you got 12 guys coming at you and you pull the fucking trigger once, chances are excellent, even if you miss, the guys are going to back away. Very few guys have the balls, unless they're suicidal or on methamphetamine, very few guys have the balls to keep on coming after the first shot is fired. Okay? You very seldom see that. Unless you're fucking his wife and he's really mad, I don't know. But, I mean, it's very rare. Okay? Most guys, and this was a perfect example here, back away when the gun comes out, even if it's not fired. Okay? But do you need 120 rounds? I mean, I guess if you're holding up for the LA riots or the Ferguson riots, you want 120 rounds in magazines. I don't know. But another thing that I was thinking of, he backed away, and then when he went a block away, he stopped, talked to his crew. I've always said you should try to get as far away as possible, which means run several blocks more, or get in the car and drive away. Well, aren't I fleeing the scene? Well, what is your defense? Your defense is that you were attacked unprovoked and feared for your life. So fleeing the scene goes a long way to backing up your claim that you're fearing for your life. Okay? And you can even listen to guys like Clint Smith from Thunder Ranch. SWAT officer, Marine. Okay? He tells people all the time, I'm going to get in my car and drive away. He did a video where he was talking about car defense. He's like, well, if I'm in my car and a guy's attacking me, I'm going to hit the gas. I'm not going to stick around. So even guys that are former police, former military, world-renowned shooters, even they're saying, wait a minute, just get the fuck away. Now, you still have to call police. And you still have to tell the police what happened. I was attacked and I ran away. This is the address I was attacked at. I was staying on this corner and a bunch of guys attacked me and I pulled out my gun, backed away, got in my car and drove away. Okay? You still gotta tell the police what happened, but getting away from the scene as far as possible backs up your theory that you are in danger, afraid for your life. Okay? Typically, if you're the person that's wrong, fleeing is gonna be considered a problem. Okay, if you have a car accident that results in injury and you flee, okay, that's going to be a problem. But I personally would recommend running as far away as fast as possible. Getting far away, getting in the car, driving, getting out of the area. Yes, tell the police you were there. Yes, tell the police you pulled your gun out. But I left the area and drove 5 miles away because I was deathly afraid. So maybe the jury thought, hey, if he backed away and a couple of blocks, he's not that afraid because they can still follow him. Okay? You don't know what goes on in the minds of a juror. Okay? Jurors have to be no less than 18 years old. be American citizens, either by birth or by naturalization process, know how to read, write, and speak English, and that's it. Guys over 70 can legally excuse themselves from jury duty, or they can say, I'll serve voluntarily on a jury. But, I mean, I for one don't know. Now, I always tell you, from the other side of the point of view, if anyone ever tells you, leave me alone, okay, I was young once too, I know you guys and your girlfriends and your boyfriends and your husbands and your wives and your and the girl you like or the boy you like or the girl that stood you up at the dance or the girl that dumped you for your best friend, okay? When someone tells you, leave me alone, I find the best thing to do is walk away. Even if you're right in the argument, okay, walk away. Because when someone says, leave me alone, in their mind, you are bothering them. And they might tell you the boss, they might tell the principal, they might tell the police. So when someone says, in your mind, someone says, leave me alone, in their mind, you are bothersome and you're better off just biting your tongue and walking away. Okay? I've had friends that have had arguments with their girlfriends. Okay, I've had friends that have arguments with other guys, other people, and they just say, just fucking chill, okay? I've had friends that, you know, get really fucking upset, and they want to punch someone's face in, and someone with a cooler head says, listen, man, let's go back away, okay? Grab them, pull them away. I've seen friends pull people away from problems when they were young. It's like school shit, like, you know, high school and shit. I've had friends pull me away from shit, full disclosure, okay? You gotta back away sometimes. Also, when someone says, you're threatening me, or I fear for my safety, or leave me the fuck alone right now, okay, in their mind, you're not being bothersome, you're being threatening. Okay, and sometimes they can press charges against you just for being threatening in their perception. Okay, so if you're on the other side of the aisle, like the Black Lives Matter guys, if you're on that side of the fence, walk away immediately, because at this point, they consider you a threat, and they might hurt you, or they might press charges against you. So I always say, from that point of view, I don't give a fuck how right you are, or how right you think you are. When someone says, leave me alone, you walk away. Maybe they'll be calm tomorrow. You know, your girlfriend, you know, she's upset, leave her alone, she'll come back tomorrow, she'll be fine. Okay, or your best friend is really mad right now because his mother is fucking the mailman. Okay, fine. Okay, take a deep breath, leave people alone. And if they think you're threatening them, back away a lot faster. Okay, but see, me personally, I and you judge it for yourself, you can leave a comment below. I personally thought that he was acting in self-defense. I thought, based on the guys that want to kill cops, based on the guys that want to kill white people, based on the guys that always break shit and steal shit and set fires, okay, he was not fleeing the Girl Scouts, okay? He was not fleeing a bunch of fourth grade girls in Girl Scout outfits, okay? He was fleeing a group of adults who belonged to an organization that is violent, and he was backing away. Now, if he was black, yeah, we're gonna go there. If he was black and he ran away and pulled a gun out on 10 or 12 guys wearing white hoods, maybe, I don't know. But I, from an unbiased perception, I personally would not have even charged him if I was the DA. That's my opinion. Maybe they know something I don't. Okay? Maybe they looked in his file and he, you know, committed assault 20 years ago. Guy's 37 years old. Okay? I don't know. But my perception of this situation, I thought that he was right to fear for his life. I would have feared for my life too. Would I have pulled out my gun or my knife If you think you're going to be run down by 10 guys, I would. Because when those 10 guys charge and knock you to the ground, okay, the concrete ground is their weapon. Because as they knock you over, you're going to fall backwards on your head. I'm drinking a goofy mug and wearing a Pirates of the Caribbean t-shirt talking about self-defense law. Yeah. But I personally would not have charged, would not have convicted or charged, or I would have, in fact, I probably would have charged them for some shit. Okay? Yeah. You got to judge yourselves. You got to look at yourself. Maybe something will come up in the future. Maybe the guy will get pardoned. Maybe there'll be an appeal filed. But, well, you know, let me go now. I'll upload a video and you can look at yourselves.